Hello, everybody. Hello. How we doing? Great. Before we start, before we even get doing anything, we always like to open with a word of prayer here at Colorado Christian University. So please join me in prayer. Lord, thank you for this wonderful afternoon. Thank you for just blue skies, for the beauty here in Colorado. Thank you for our friends, Al and Lisa Robertson, Megan Alexander, who are so faithful to you while being in the spotlight. Bless our conversation tonight. Bless the students here at CCU and the work that we do to influence our culture. We pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen. Great. Well, welcome. My name is Jeff Hunt. I'm the director of the Centennial Institute here at Colorado Christian University. What is the Centennial Institute? That is a great question. The Centennial Institute is the think tank housed here at Colorado Christian University. Our role is to implement one of the strategic objectives here at the college. The one that we are set to fulfill is to impact our culture in support of traditional family values, sanctity of life, compassion for the poor, biblical view of human nature, limited government, personal freedom, free markets, natural law, original intent of the Constitution, and Western civilization. Hoorah, right? Good stuff. Amen. Notice the phrase, impact our culture. Now, most of what we do is in public policy. We engage in political issues. We host the Western Conservative Summit, a lot of that. But impacting culture is a lot more than just public policy debates. It's actually engaging in culture and changing culture itself. It's often said that culture is upstream of politics, and I, for the most part, agree with that. What happens in culture shapes the political debate. It's also been said, give me the songs of a nation, it matters not who writes its laws. I'll say that again, give me the songs of a nation, and it matters not who writes its laws. Christians must be active in culture, not just Christian culture, but popular culture. We need to be influencing what popular culture consumes freely. When we can shape what they consume freely, we have a tremendous impact. The left has gotten that for the last 40 years, and has done it very well. Conservatives need to do it much, much better. We need to influence movies, video games, television. That's why the think tank at CCU is hosting Faith in the Spotlight to explore how Christians are successfully engaging popular culture. And today we have three fantastic guests that are going to explore a little bit more about what that means. Al Robertson grew up hunting, fishing, and helping build the family business in the 1970s and 80s. Allen left Duck Commander when he received the call for ministry in 1988 and served as a senior pastor in West Monroe, Louisiana until 2012 when he rejoined the Duck Commander clan. Now get this, this is just amazing. I didn't know this about Duck Dynasty. The show has, and I'm a big fan, I've even got my tie. This is the Duck Dynasty tie. The show has broken several rating records on A&E and cable television as a whole. The fourth season premiere drew 11.8 million viewers, the most watched nonfiction cable series in history. It's bigger than the Kardashians. Yeah, good stuff. Yeah, there you go. Lisa Robertson is his wife and worked with him at the church in several different ministries before joining him back at Duck Commander. She's on the show as well. She's a committed mother and grandmother and guides her family in the ways of faith. Together, they have written many books, including one that's very important. I strongly recommend it. A new season, A Robertson Family Love Story of Brokenness and Redemption. So make sure you check that out. In fact, we're going to have a book signing later, so you can get that book here tonight. Megan Alexander is a national news correspondent, author, speaker, and actress. She can be seen every evening as a correspondent on the longest-running television syndicated national news magazine television show, Inside Edition. She also covers Thursday night football on CBS and is the author of a new book called Faith in the Spotlight, Thriving in Your Career While Staying True to Your Beliefs. Megan and I are friends from back when we went to a Christian college together. So what you're seeing with Megan is what Christian colleges are producing, people of strong faith and character that are influencing media at the highest levels, which is very exciting. I will not be moderating tonight. In fact, our wonderful director of events, Ashton Belk, somewhere around here. There she is. Ashton Belk, who earned her BA in journalism and TV production from Colorado State University, went on to work for media network leader Viacom at country music television in a variety of departments, including creative, .com, on-air promotions, programming and series development, off-air production and special events. She left the U.S. to work abroad in Croatia, producing a travel TV series. She's now and we're very lucky at Colorado Christian University to have her as our director of events and the executive producer of our flagship events, the Western Conservative Summit. So please join me in welcoming our guests.
You guys just want to go ahead on here? You guys can go ahead and fill in and wherever you'd like to be at.
So we'll go ahead and get comfortable here for you guys today, because really we do want to just open this up to be able to have a conversation about what it is like to be able to, for these people as well as for the future of some of our students here, to be able to live in the spotlight and live within our culture and still be able to uphold your values and your beliefs. So what I'd like to start out by doing, we'll let Megan go ahead and go first, and then we'll bring Al and Lisa. And I would like them just to go ahead and tell you a little bit about their journey, their testimony, and how it is that they came to be in the spotlight. So Megan.
Hello. Yes, I do work in the business. I should know how to turn on a mic. Sorry about that. Hello, everybody. I'm so glad that you're here. Thanks for coming. As mentioned, Megan Alexander, I work for Inside Edition. I've been with the show for 8 years, have been in television, radio, film for over a decade now, about 14 years in the business total. And also for the past 2 years, covered Thursday Night Football on CBS for all the local stations across the country. And also an actress and a producer of some projects. Little bit about me. So born and raised in Seattle, Washington, and raised in a Christian home, went to one of just a few Christian schools in Seattle, and had a moment in high school. You know, I was one of those kids that liked to try a little bit of everything, loved to perform. I'm one of two girls in my family. I'm the second, so benefited from watching my older sister do a lot of things and admiring her. And then in high school, I remember getting ready for prom with a group of friends. And one of the guys in our group, his dad was there, the Reverend Shields. He was a pastor. And I remember him asking all the kids, you know, what do you want to be when you grow up? What are you excited about? What are you going to study in college? And I remember sort of apologizing and saying to him, the pastor, well, I think I want to be a news anchor. I know it's media and entertainment, but I think that's what God's called me to do. I think I have those skills and talents. And he said to me something that was a defining moment for me. He said, Megan, every job is a ministry. Every job is a mission field. That was an empowering moment for me to hear that from him and to know that my world had just opened up and that God could use me in whatever way I felt he was calling me. It was a big moment. From high school, I headed to Westmont College. Jeff and I met there. Wonderful school, had that great liberal arts education. You guys are getting that here. There was no broadcast journalism department. I majored in political science and just got on the job training. I think I did about 7 different internships before I got my first paid job and just got involved and started, you know, finding out what it was like to be on set when breaking news happened and started getting bit parts acting and writing and producing. And it was one of those things where, you know, my parents, my father worked in finance, is getting ready to retire from Merrill Lynch and Bank of America in Seattle, has had a great career. My mom was a stay-at-home mom some of the time with my sister and I, also an educator and worked in the art history world. They knew no one in the business. They said, honey, good luck. We don't have a friend in media or entertainment. You're on your own. So I had 0 friends and went after it myself. And I remember cold calling radio stations my senior year at Westmont and emailing radio stations and television stations. And one station got back to me. Not country music, not pop music, not hip hop, not anything sexy. Classical music. My first job was the midnight to 6 a.m. shift, classics till sunrise. But I got my foot in the door. I got my foot in the door and learned so much and was thrilled to even be making $9 an hour at that station. And it began there. And I started planting seeds. And God kept opening doors. And I kept feeling like this was where I was supposed to be. And one thing led to the next. I went to Nashville, Tennessee, worked in radio there, tons of different part-time jobs. You know, again, you're just trying to figure out your way. And then I got a chance to fill in for a week at a television station in Nashville, got my tape made, which now is a DVD or whatever it is that they still email, and heard that San Antonio, Texas was looking for a morning traffic reporter and a co-host for an entertainment show that they had. Got the first job down there and sort of just kept doing my thing. I didn't have this big master plan, but I was confident that God wanted me to work in this industry. And I shared this morning with the Robertsons at these different events that we've done, I didn't start out wearing my WWJD bracelet in this industry. I didn't wear the cross necklace. I didn't wear my faith on my sleeve. I wanted to be known for good work. I wanted to be known for being an excellent reporter, a good host, a good producer, a good writer. And that really has become the theme of my book, which is a seat at the table. I believe that we need to take a seat at the table as believers in society, especially in careers of influence. I realize sitting up here before you, I'm not a doctor saving lives. I'm not a teacher influencing the next generation. I'm not a foster parent. But whether we like it or not, I am in an industry that is incredibly influential in shaping culture. And I'll just read you something that Tim Keller, a pastor of Redeemer Presbyterian Church in New York, a wonderful author, that he wrote that just really nailed it for me in terms of what this is all about. He says, "Why? As the city goes, so goes the culture. Cultural trends tend to be generated in the city and flow outward toward the rest of society. People who live in large urban cultural centers, occupying jobs in the arts, business, academics, publishing, helping professions, and yes, media, tend to have a disproportionate impact on how things are done in culture. Having lived and ministered in New York City for 17 years, I am continually astonished at how the people living here affect what everyone else in the United States sees on screen, in print, in art, and in business." In other words, I'm in such an incredibly influential industry. That's where I need to be. And when I got into this industry, I had people say to me, "That's Satan's playground. Why do you want to work in media and entertainment?" Isn't that exactly where we should go? Isn't that exactly where we should be? So it's San Antonio for a couple years. Live television. I co-hosted this morning show called Great Day SA, which is a lot like a Good Morning America for Texas. And again, here I am, this young 20-something on live television, needing to suddenly decide, who's I going to be on air versus off air? Is that going to be the same person? These real life scenarios and these real life questions. And I'll just share a couple stories before I pass it on to the Robertsons here. But a big one for me was, as I began co-hosting this show, my co-host, who's a dear friend, not a believer, but a wonderful person and a great co-host, she had a serious boyfriend. I knew about it. I've met him. He's a great guy. And I remember on air once on our television show, she said she was single. And, you know, just kind of rolled with the conversation. And then when the show was over that day, I said, "Hey, are you still with Jeff?" And she's like, "Oh, yeah, I'm very much taken and with Jeff. But on camera, I'm single. I'm available." And I just thought, wow. Okay, and think about that one for a second, guys. The next time you hear a TV host tell you they're single on air, what's really going on behind the scenes? But that just kind of opened up my world of, wait a second, people aren't the same on and off camera? What does a believer do? What do we do with that when the Bible tells us that the Lord detests lying lips and, you know, the truth will set you free? What do we do with that? And my producer on the show went and chatted with him, and he said, "Megan, I'd prefer you appear single." Now, I was dating my now husband. He was my boyfriend at the time. And I had to make a decision. Who was I going to be? Studied, you know, what the Bible says, how I was raised. And I just said, hey, I got to be me. And my faith says I'm supposed to be truthful on and off camera. Went on the next show and started talking about my boyfriend. And I didn't look back. And that was a real life moment that's just important to share, because I had no idea being on that television show that was going to be a part of what I would need to decide as a believer. And from then on, it was little situations and little moments and different stories and how I was going to react. Got to Inside Edition. I've been with the show now for 8 years, and I can share similar stories with you. I really believe that, you know, we need to have people in the room when stories are going down and decisions are being made. I don't believe personally, my personal take, I don't believe there is a big conspiracy or a big effort to keep believers out of media or entertainment. I just don't think there's a lot of us there. I just don't think there's a lot of us in the room. I've seen that in my career, that the different people that I've worked with, church just isn't a big part of their life. It's just not. And so when I talk about what I did on the weekend and I say I've gone to church, they're like, "That's what my grandparents do. You still go to church?" It's just not a part of who they are. I don't see it as much in New York City, which is why we need believers there to be in the mix and taking a seat at the table. The book tackles that from a variety of angles. I don't think that there's a book out there right now for the young millennial that's needing to tackle this conversation, especially for women of faith. It kind of crystallized for me the need to write this book when I got an email from a pastor in Seattle a couple years ago. And he said to me, Megan, I have a church full of young, ambitious women with big career goals and dreams in secular society. They are worried to get that corner office, to climb the ladder, to host that show or get that part. They're going to need to compromise their faith to get ahead. I have few role models, especially in entertainment, but I know of you. Would you come speak to my church? And I said, I'd love to come speak to your church. I'll take it one step further. I'm going to write this book. Again, didn't ever think that this would sort of be me in my life and what I'd be doing now, but I think there comes a moment when you look around and you go, well, nobody else is doing it. Lord, am I supposed to do this? Okay, here we go. So I wrote the book, and it tackles mentors, body image, being a female in this image-obsessed industry. What do we do with that? Remembering who you are in the moment, covering the NFL as a female and my different experiences there, negotiating a contract. How do we do that as believers and as strong women? What's it like? I had 2 years, specifically with my NFL gig, where I negotiated my own contracts. Fabulous experience. And I want to encourage and especially empower women that it is possible. And so I share my stories with that. And, you know, I really believe that there's some fear out there about being in mainstream media, if you will. And I want to just encourage, and I don't want people to be fearful because it is indeed possible. At the end of the day, you know, people have asked me since you wrote this book, what's the atmosphere been like, you know, at Inside Edition? And I tell them, you know, I went into it wanting to do good work. And again, I didn't really talk about my faith that much in the beginning. And I'm hopeful that I established myself as Megan Alexander, the reporter. She'll meet deadlines. We can count on her. My photographer knows we're in this together. We're a team. My boss knows I can deliver for him. They knew that girl first. So now when I'm talking about my faith, it's just, okay, that's just Megan. That's just another part of her life that she's talking about. My boss has been incredibly supportive of this because he's a father and he loves the idea of anyone encouraging women to value themselves, to set goals, to think highly of their dreams and their life. So that has been my approach. I realize this is not one size fits all. Every day is different. Every situation is different. But I'm excited to just share with you a bit about my experience. So excited and proud for you to hear from the Robertsons now, who have had a blast spending this whole day with. And it's them doing projects and shows like they're doing that I'm allowed to then be the messenger and report on Duck Dynasty on Inside Edition. And how cool is that? Because they're doing what they're doing. So I'm going to pass it off to them now, and we'll take questions in a bit. Thank you, everybody.
Thank you so much, Megan. And just so you know, too, earlier today we did have the opportunity to have a couple different events where we all came together and we were able to even be with some young women, some of your young women here at CCU, and everyone walked away. These young women walked away, a couple sitting here too, but all so encouraged by the message that these two groups of people were able to share with them. Because really, they're here to be able to give you the ability to know that you can do this too. And that if not you, then who? And so with that too, thank you, Megan. And if you guys want to go ahead and share your story, we'd love to hear it.
We'd love to. how many of you have ever seen Duck Dynasty? Just, I'm curious. Oh, good. A lot of you. That's excellent. You know, it's amazing because we had not met Megan before today and how similar our philosophy was in going into what we are into, and they're totally different, and yet in many ways they're a lot alike. And the show came out, you know, and obviously it became very successful very quickly, and you know, so people began to talk about it, as they'll do, and they said, you got to check out this show. You know, it's called, you know, so what is it? It's called Duck Dynasty. What is it, a Chinese restaurant? What is that? What does that mean, Duck Dynasty? And so they said, well, you know, it's kind of like Andy Griffith, the Waltons, a little Dukes of Hazzard sprinkled in there, you know. And it's these, you know, bearded people from Louisiana, you know, and they begin to tell they build duck calls. And so I was like, what is the deal? So we set out, you know, with the same philosophy Megan had, not to make a spiritual or religious show, but to make a really good and funny show that networks would pick up. And of course, you know, our faith was always a part of who we were, but we weren't going to be the 700 Club for Rednecks. You know, we were actually going to have, you know, a funny show that, that people would like, and they do. And a lot of young people like it first, which is awesome. I always compared our show to the Munsters. Has anybody ever seen the Munsters? All the young people are like, why though? Why? Well, they do have TV Land, by the way, so check it out sometime. Munsters is a great old 60s show, kind of like the shows were of that era. And so the concept was they had this family of monsters, and they had this beautiful cousin come to live with them. Now, those of you that know the show, do you know her name? Marilyn. Two people remember Marilyn Munster. That's the problem with beautiful people living with ugly people. They don't remember them. Well, I can completely relate to Marilyn Munster. I got it. I got the Marilyn Munster complex because, you know, I live with the people that I live with. I'm the only Robertson male that's never been mistaken as homeless. This guy right here. That's 100% true. Everybody has a story, some multiple stories, you know. I've been walking behind Dad inside an airport before, and I was trailing them, you know, maybe, you know, 15 or 20 feet back, and they walked past this this woman and a little girl, and the little girl looked up as they walked by, and as I'm walking by, she told her mom, look at those poor, poor men. You know, like, how did they get in an airport, you know? And so, you know, that you don't know, right? You don't know till you know. When you look at a family photo of the brothers, you can see that we weren't born with beards, contrary to what a lot of people think. We're not sure about Uncle Si. There's no record of his birth, by the way, just so you know. He may have been born with a beard. But you look at the, and then you look and see what happens. You're like, you know, how does this happen? How does did my dad go in as senior of high school, sit down with a guidance counselor and say, you know, I'm thinking about letting myself go. I'm not going to cut my hair, shave my beard. Bathing will be optional. You know, and then I'm going to be successful, run a large company, and become a huge voice for the conservative evangelicals in America. I mean, you wouldn't script it that way, which means that God must have had something to do with it, right? And so we believe that to be true. I want to tell you a little bit about our personalities, kind of how they are and set up, just to give you a little background for the brothers and my dad, my Uncle Si. And I'm going to do that by using Labrador Retrievers as my illustration. I don't know if any of you have a lab dog. Labs are wonderful animals. You know, they're our go-to dog for retrieving. And the Black Lab is particularly a good dog. I mean, he is the go-getter. He will break through ice, water. He's whimpering by the truck. He wants to go get a duck as much as we want to shoot a duck. I mean, that's how much Black Labs love it. Now, in our family, the Black Labs are my dad, the duck commander, and Jace. They both have that in them. I mean, it's never too cold. They're never too sick. We may not have shot a duck in 7 days, and it's like, boys, today's going to be the day we get them. They're Black Labs. They're always ready to go. Now, a Yellow Lab is a great hunting dog. They'll go get your ducks, but they're also very domesticated. They'll hang out at the house. They'll look after the kids. They make great service pets, you know, because they're very connected to people. Well, that's me, yours truly, Beardless Brother. And my brother, Jep, who we also call my little sister because he's very sensitive. The two of us are Yellow Labs. That's what we are. And we don't mind that. We don't mind being, you know, we get used and abused because we'll stay home and sleep in. We hadn't killed any ducks. It's okay. We don't have to turn in our man card. We're Yellow Labs. It's all right. We like people. Now, any dog breeder will tell you, take those two dog breeds and you cross them, which you begin to break down the breed of a dog, by the way, and you get a Chocolate Lab. So that's a combination of those two. Now, the problem here is that as you break down a breed of a dog, what happens is they get kooky and crazy, and you don't know what you're going to get. So you get a Chocolate Lab that may be a real go-getter, and the other one may not know come here from Sikkim. You know, that's just the way it is. In our family, believe it or not, the Chocolate Lab is my brother, Willie. He's the CEO of our company. He seems to have it all together. I'm telling you today, that's just, he puts the ADD in ADD. He's very all over the place. And so you never know with Willie. But when I try to think of a lab to describe my Uncle Si, there's only one I know. Well, there it is. Boom. Those of you that watch our show, you know that's true, right? My Uncle Si is really the star of our show. He's the one that people love to watch. And if you think of Andy Griffith, you think of Uncle Si's Barney. You know, that's the reason you like that show, right? He's hilarious. Uncle Si was in the military for 25 years. He was in Vietnam in 1968. That's his picture. If you look at him now and then, you think, man, the years have been unkind to Uncle Si. He's lived through a lot, right? But he's a wonderful, godly, and spiritual man. He just started. He wants to do a music career, and he's fronting a band called Si and the Psychotics. That's really true. And so the bad thing is he can't sing, but we don't have the heart to tell him that. So we're just letting him follow his dreams. Let me tell you a little bit about my folks and kind of what led us to be here in a part of part of the show. My mom and dad was here not too long ago and spoke at the Western Conservatives, and I heard he did a great job. Mom and dad, of course, are really the glue and the heart and soul of our show, and especially mom. She just has a way. Everybody loves Miss Kay, you know, and I always tell people the reason you love her is the reason we love her as our mom. She's the real deal. They were teenagers, 16 and 14 years old, when they first found each other. My grandpa, my mom's dad, had just passed away suddenly. And so her mother, who was much younger than him and depended on him, just really lost it and went off the deep end, turned to alcohol, and just basically left the home. So mom is 14 years old. Her older sister's out of the home, married. Her mom is off the deep end. Her dad is dead. And so she just really was left there. And so my dad came in at that moment, 16 years old. He's the quarterback of the football team. She's the cheerleader, you know, and they began a relationship. Unfortunately, like a lot of teenagers who spend too much time alone and without supervision, when mom was 16, she found out she was pregnant with me. Dad was about to start at Louisiana Tech. And so, you know, even in 1964, she was faced with a decision about what to do about that. As a guy who's sitting here who's about to be 52 years old, I'm very happy to say I'm glad that she chose life in that moment, or I wouldn't be able to be talking to you today. But it was very hard. That's a hard choice because it was a tough life for them. Dad went on to Louisiana Tech and, of course, became a very good quarterback there. Terry Bradshaw was his backup, interestingly enough, while they were there. So it was pretty interesting. But Dad also lost his way during this period of time spiritually. And of course, mom did as well. And so my first 10 years of my life were really growing up in a non-Christian home with a dad who drank too much, spent too much time in the woods and killing stuff, and not enough time home taking care of his boys. And he'll tell you that to this day. So the man he is now, he is that way because Christ was renewed in him and he became that man. And so he's been very open about that, as with all of us. The episode that Jeff mentioned earlier was an episode called Till Duck Do Us Part, and it was the fourth season premiere. It was also my premiere on the show. 11.8 million homes that night tuned in to watch this 50-year celebration of mom and dad. I always look at it as my debut on Duck Dynasty, largest show ever. I mean, I'm not saying it's because of me. I'm just saying I happen to be on there. So, but anyway, it was a very special time for our family. It was also a special time for me because I walked through a lot of the difficult days being there for mom, looking out for my brothers when my dad wasn't there. And she relied a lot on me. We're very close today. She's very close to Lisa as well. And that's because we built that. That was a dynamic for our family. I lost my way as a teenager. I became a prodigal son for about 4 years. Wound up leaving my home, leaving the church, leaving Lisa. I broke her heart. When she was a sophomore in high school, when I graduated, I was 17 years old, and Dad had that sit-down conversation with me that, Al, you got a choice here. You can change, or you got to go. And what's interesting is this is the same choice he had quite a few years earlier. He's either had to change or he was going to lose his family. He changed. I didn't. It took me a couple more years. I had to kind of get that pig pen experience. You remember the prodigal son in Luke 15? He woke up in the hog pen, thought, what am I doing here? The same thing happened to me on the wrong end of a jealous husband's crowbar in New Orleans, Louisiana. It was my pig pen moment. And in that moment, I wrote, you know what? Life in North Louisiana was not too bad. And all this drinking and drugging is really not going to advance me very far. And so I realized at 18 years old that I wouldn't see 19 if I stayed in New Orleans and continued that way. So I kind of worked myself up a good speech. And I was going to do just like that prodigal son in Luke 15. I was going to go home and convince my dad to just hire me. I didn't deserve to be a son, but if I could just be a hired hand, it would work. They met me in the yard, and they hugged me, and they didn't give me a long list of sins, and they didn't tell me about all the wrong things I did. They did just like the Father did in Luke 15, which is represented, by the way, of any of us that lose our way. They embraced me and welcomed me back. That night, we killed the fattened catfish and had a celebration because a lost son had come home. And so I began my life anew. I called Lisa up. She was in high school. Come on back up, man. She was in high school, and she was dating a guy pretty seriously. And I'd heard that, you know. And I it had never left me that I had broken her heart. And her life had gone into a complete tailspin for that 2 years after. And I knew a little bit about that. And so I wanted to make amends and do right by her. And also, I wanted a girl who loved me enough that would settle down and want to live a life with me. 32 years later, obviously, I picked the right one to be able to do that. But I called her up, and I said, I'm back in town. Because, I was still a little bit, Rico Suave. I thought I still had it, even though I was a new creature. I told Lisa, I said, I'm back in town. And she said, I heard you were back. And I said, I heard you're dating this guy, like, super serious and all this. I'm here and talk, And she said, oh, yeah, we're talking about getting married when I get out of high school. And I said, well, you want to go out Friday? And then there was a pause, and then
I said, absolutely.
So that poor guy never had a chance. So we had a second first date, because our first date was horrible, because I was horrible. And we built a relationship. And we were going to wait a year to get married, but we also, this time, we're going to do it the right way, and no sex, and we were going to be committed to Christ. So 6 months in, we said, if we're going to hold our commitment, we might ought to step that timetable up just a little bit. And we did. So I asked her to marry me on Friday, November the 2nd. And
we got married Friday, November the 9th.
Which I didn't believe in long engagements, because my thinking was, if you wanted to spend the rest of your life with someone, you want the rest of your life to begin as soon as possible, right? And this made me really a big hit with her parents, especially her mom. And it took us about 12 years to work through that one, by the way. It can be done. You have to be humble, men, if you pull that stunt. But we got married, and we had a lot of issues. We brought a lot of what we call unpacked bags into our relationship, and it took us a while to sort them out, quite a few years, in fact. But 32 years later, we have a beautiful family now. Show that next picture. That's the us of today. Oh, that's us at the wedding. And me with a beard, by the way, when my brothers couldn't grow one. And then that's our family now. My youngest daughter was pregnant with our youngest grandson in that picture. He's not there yet. Now he is. They named him, youngest daughter's husband is named Vinny Mancuso, Vincent Mancuso. He's Italian Cajun, which is quite the combination. And they named my youngest grandson Doc Santino Mancuso. And I was like, you have created a mafia hitman for my youngest son. What kind of name is this? But we love our grandkids and the blessing. And one thing I'll do to close before we do the Q&A, we went to Alaska last year doing some work for our cruise. And while we were there, we met this wonderful artist. And so we went into his studio, and he had these beautiful paintings. The first one was the Northern Lights. That's on there. Show that one. And it's like at one end, and it's just fantastic. I mean, it's the whole end of a wall. So when you walk in, you see it from like 100 feet away, and it looks literally like you're looking at the Northern Lights. So I tell Lisa, I said, we're going to get a print before we leave here today. She said, oh, I'm excited. So we saw these beautiful. The next one was Mount McKinley, which is Mount Denali now. It's like, oh, this guy and this artwork. And then I saw this next one, and Lisa wasn't with me when I saw it. And it's like Alaska in hell, is what it looks like. And it is Alaskan landscape, and it's a little hard to see because of the picture. But when I saw it, I was like, something about it just drew me to it. And I don't know if you can tell. You can tell a little bit. You can see right here at the foot of this tree or whatever that is, there's like a guy there. He's kind of bent down. He's kneeling down. And about halfway up that road, there he is again. And up on top of the mountain, which is kind of brighted out, you can't see him, he's up there with his hands raised. And when I saw that, and I saw the name was Through the Fires of Pain, it just spoke so much to me about my own life, about mine and Lisa's life, about our family's life, and about what God can do when we're broken and we give ourselves to it. And so I told Lisa, I announced that that was the print that we were going to get. And Lisa said, that's so ugly. You know, she didn't see the name or know the story. And I was like, but wait till you hear the story. And so after I told the story, she agreed. And so we bought that and we framed it. And now it's hanging above our bed as a reminder that to have a relationship, you have to go through some difficulty and let God do what he does best through that. And that's exactly what led to our book. And that's where we talk about that openly. It's really neat because Megan found the book at Inside Edition because the publishers have probably sent it there when we released it last year. And she just saw it on her way out of the office and thought, oh, that's the people I'm going to be with. Got it and read it and knows about our story. Now, I can't wait to read her book on the way home or our way home because we definitely have a new friend. So anyway, that's the basis behind our book, behind our life, where we are. We came out with a new couples devotional book. It's for married couples and premarital couples as well to build spiritual intimacy. So we're very excited about that and the work that God is doing with us. So we appreciate being here today. Thank you.
Now, to start off with, too, we will open it up for Q&A for you guys as well. But a couple initial questions. When you guys are looking at the initial times that you were called into, and Megan, you were saying you felt a calling on your life to be able to go into the media, and for you all going from being a pastor and being in a church and now stepping forward into the media, what was it that drew you there, and what was it that keeps you still working in the media now?
It is a combination of thinking that I had skills and talents I could give. I had a gift to give. God, I believe, calls and places something in all of our hearts. What is that for you? You know, that's the journey in life, is to figure that out. What am I made for? What am I created for? A combination of that and then realizing, I think you get to a point in life where you realize, okay, if I'm frustrated with something, I can either complain about it and do nothing, or I can jump in and try to do something. And so very much for me, I just thought, I want to get in there. I just want to get in there. Again, it's that thought of people telling me, you know, it's Satan's playground. Why would you want to be a part of that? That's exactly where we should be. And I'll tell you, there are cool things going on in the industry that you don't always see. It's not always the story that makes the evening news or that's on our show. A lot of cool things going on behind the scenes. So it was a combination of that and, again, just saying, okay, Lord, close these doors if you want to. If that, you need to tell me I'm not supposed to be in this industry because I'm going to keep on going, and close those doors if I'm supposed to do something else. And he just kept opening up the doors. It's a marathon. It's not a sprint. Again, all these part-time jobs lead to this, lead to that, long hours, working holidays, being away from my family. My hubby is at home with our two boys, age 1 and 5, and I'm the parent in the family that travels all the time to New York City every week for work. So if you have that passion, work is life and life is work, then it all makes sense. It's what I think is God's destiny for me. And my passion in writing the book is to help others figure that out too, and to not have that fear. So it's a combination of those things.
Thanks. Yeah, and for us, I think it was not necessarily trying to become famous. We all did ministry, every one of us in our own way. Megan's right. Every opportunity, every job is an opportunity to minister to someone. You grow where you're planted, you know, for the kingdom. But in our case, we were doing hunting DVDs, and so we were known in the hunting industry. And then those doors kept opening for us. Somebody comes along and says, you know what, you guys need to be on national television doing what you do. And so we had a hunting show on the Outdoor Channel. But they started putting some reality elements in there about our wives. In fact, the picture that's on the flyer you guys did, that's from that show when we took the wives hunting, which, by the way, they've never been back. So just so you know, they don't like it at all. They don't like to get up early in the morning. They don't like to be cold. They don't like a lot of stuff. And so but that was the next step. And so we just did it and loved it and saw that the outreach was a little bit bigger, but we were still who we were. And personally at our own church, we were still, you know, evangelizing people and witnessing, doing all the things we had always done. Anytime we had an opportunity in front of a crowd, we share, you know, who we are. And then this next thing comes. And it's really interesting because in our case, the producers first came down. And of course, Willie was really pushing it. You know, I mean, Chocolate Lab, you know, at this point, he's running off. You know, we got to do the show. And Dad, you know, wasn't so convinced. And the rest of us weren't sure. And so we're kind of, it's kind of now the struggle at the top, you know, because Dad's the duck commander. He's the one. But Willie's kind of the heir apparent. So they're like trying to figure out, should we do this as a family? And the producers came into Dad's living room. And so they're telling, they're making their pitch, and Dad's just sitting there like a cigar store Indian, you know, just looking at him like he does. You see the show, his thumbs up or thumbs down, right? And so he's watching them, and then he reaches over in his bag, and he pulls out his Bible, and he holds it up. And it's got duct tape all over it. If those of you who saw him speak, you saw it. And he holds it up, and he says, is this in on this deal, on this show? And of course, they're all looking like, you know, and the producer kind of gulps, you know, and he says, well, Mr. Robertson, I mean, if that's part of your life and that's who you are, then that'll be on the show. And he said, well, if this is in, then I'm in. And he put it back in the bag. And so for us, it was just a moment to realize that's who we were, and they were going to recognize that. And it really did. Like I said, even though we weren't making a religious show, obviously our spiritual qualities come through on camera, and it gives us an opportunity off camera to do what we do. So like Megan, we just felt like we take every step forward that God was opening up for us. And even when we went through a major national controversy, trust me, every night when you watch the nightly news cycle and you're on it, you know, it's very interesting to do that. Every day in the duck blind when that was going on, we would digest everything we'd seen the night before. You know, you should have seen CNN. You should have seen this guy. So even through those days, we still felt like it was what we were supposed to be doing. And that became a little polarizing for us, but at the same time, it also was who we were, you know. And if you ask us something about the Bible, we're going to tell you, and especially Dad, and he'll tell you a lot about it. So anyway, I think that's kind of how it came to be for us.
So as far as you're talking about the media too reporting on y'all, what is it like now having social media and everybody has a voice and everybody can speak into your lives, and they can speak positively, they can speak negatively, and how does that have an influence on who you all are and how you step forward day to day?
That's a great question, because obviously we use social media a lot to put forth what we're about and what we're trying to do, so it's a tool for us, but also it is a definite opinion that runs the gamut. I can always tell when I do some shows that are on a lot of liberal you know, precincts, when they're like, you know, they really watch this group that I'm speaking for, because I mean, my social media gets lit up, and it's usually ugly, the stuff that comes out. So I always know, gear up, it's coming, because we're going to hear from that, and we know. But at the same time, like anything else, it can be used as a tool for good or evil. It can be used as something to build up or tear down. And so what we're trying to do is use that platform as much as we can. Sadie and the younger ones, the people who actually know about stuff like that, unlike old guys like me, they really use it to their advantage to get out some wonderful things. I mean, millions and millions and millions of people seeing a positive message from a teenage Christian about how they should live. And so I think we try to take positive advantage of it. We do have to realize that there will always be negative. You know, there's going to come our way. That's us. What about you, Meg?
I also have enjoyed the feedback. You know, for so long it was one-sided. The evening news would come on, or Inside Edition would come on, and it just goes out, and we don't know what y'all are thinking. You could email or you could write letters, and I still get snail mail letters still. but I've enjoyed the feedback, whether it's encouragement or, you know, criticism of stories too. I think you have more power now. And that's another thing that I always want to encourage people with when I talk, is I think you vote in this country, yes, at the ballot box, but also with the remote control and with your phone, what you click on and what channel you're watching. Ratings are king in our industry. And so you have more power than you think. A lot of people say, gosh, why are these stories on air? I'm so sick of this garbage over and over again. You're clicking on it. You're clicking on it and you're consuming it, and that's part of it. So I just want to empower you that I think it's really cool that there's so many different ways now that you can respond and give your opinion and give your feedback. And you're right, the good and the bad come with it, of course. But I also agree with the Robertsons. I see it as it can be used for good.
Great. And as far as your families go too, so your family, clearly, you guys are very impacted by all of the voices that are out there. And then Megan too, I know that people have to be responding and asking about your kids and your husband and how life works for your family within the media spotlight. So can you speak to that a little bit? And especially Lisa, I'd love to hear from you too.
Well, our teenagers have really taken to being very open with their faith. So I think that has been a positive thing that has come out of our TV show. You know, we kind of worried at first what would happen because they're just thrown out there. We're the ones that, you know, decided to do the show, and our kids really had no choice in the matter. But they really just took it and ran with it. Sadie and John Luke and Reed and Cole, Brighton, Little Will, they all just did a Live Original tour in 17 cities in 3 weeks. And it was, the focus was for young people, you guys' age. And they did that because they wanted to be a light. They wanted to talk about a light in the dark world. And so for us, we just think that they are, they're doing very well with that. Our girls are grown, so we don't, you know, they're really not affected by the show one way or another. But our lives have changed, some for the good and some for the bad. I would say the good is that we get to travel all over the country, and we get to talk to people and tell them about Christ. We get to tell them our struggles. We get to tell them our victories. But we always point back to Christ, so he's always glorified. I think the negative is whenever you're in the spotlight, there's always people out there who are gunning for you. And they always want a piece of you because you're doing good. So they've got to find something to tear you down with. But not only that, there are people out there who have mental conditions who will come after you. And so we live in a gated subdivision, which we didn't put up until the show came out. Alan and I are not behind that gate. I'm not exactly sure what that means. I always say, well, I don't want to be behind the gate with Willie and Jason Jep. I think I'm safer on the outside of the gate. But Phil and Kay, even for years, for as long as I've been in this family, people, their door has been open. You never know whenever you go to their house who would be there. In the morning when the boys woke up, they never knew who was going to be asleep on the floor. You would find wet clothes everywhere because someone had given their life to Christ the night before, 1 or 2 a.m. in the morning. That can't happen anymore because of that gate. And it can't happen because people will take advantage of that. Now, it does still happen, but it's vetted. They go through somebody else to get to us, and, you know, when we know that it's safe, then they can do that. So the media has really helped us in a lot of ways, help us get our message out there, because we truly feel like that this is of God. We feel like this is our platform because he's the one that put us here, not us. This has nothing to do with us, but everything to do with him. And so, you know, it's been good and bad. It has been more, 100 times more good than bad. You know, our privacy, when you go out to a restaurant, it's kind of hard to eat whenever you have people continuously interrupting you while you're eating. Miss Kay says that whenever she takes her granddaughters, and our granddaughters are part of that too, that she takes them on Wednesday and they go and eat dinner before church. But whenever people approach, she always says, you can take pictures of us, but I'm not going to get up and take a picture with you because this is my time with my granddaughters. And so if, you know, we don't mind if you take a picture. We don't mind even if you get over here behind us and somebody snaps a shot. But I'm not going to get up and I'm not going to sign autographs because this is my time with them. So, you know, there's good and bad to all of it, but I would definitely tell you that the good has totally outweighed the bad for our lives the whole time.
Aristotle says, if you want to avoid criticism, do nothing, say nothing, be nothing. It's a part of it. And I cannot relate to the Robertsons because they are at a totally different level with the way that they've lived their life. I think it is the coolest thing. The Live Original Tour, I think that is so awesome. And I love that that next generation gets that. For me, I've tasted a little bit of it. My book is 90% career, but there is a chapter in my book called Sleep Your Way to the Top. And it's my story of abstinence. And so in terms of my personal life, you know, it's just me and the family that's on television. My hubby's more of the stay-at-home dad with my two boys, although he does work too. But I'm the traveling parent, as I said. But the way that I got sort of a taste of having my personal life also be a part of things is a couple of years ago, like I said, didn't come into this industry really knowing how much I was going to talk about my faith. But a couple of years ago, my phone rang and it was my pastor's wife in New York City. And she called me and she said, Megan, this Christian women's magazine called me, Woe Woman Magazine. They want to do an issue on sex, dating, and relationships. And they want to put someone on the cover who waited until they were married. They can't find anybody. So she called my pastor's wife and said, do you know anybody in New York City that works in media and entertainment? And my pastor's wife, Lynette, said, I do. Let me call her and see if she wants to talk about it publicly. I don't know. And so she called me up and I talked to my husband about it. And we said, they're not really talking about abstinence anymore. I see these young people faced with an incredible amount of pressure. We said, if it encourages one person, it's worth it. Some of the older generation in our family, well, they were not keen to us talking about this publicly, but we said, we need to talk about it, and it's our story. So I did the article for the magazine, was on the cover of this Christian women's magazine. Again, thought it would end there. At Inside Edition, we always keep our boss informed of our side projects, if we have a part in a movie, if we're, you know, emceeing a charity event or a cause. So I put the magazine on my boss's desk with a little post-it note. Hey, boss, you know, heads up. I'm on the cover of this magazine talking about my abstinence story. Just FYI. I figured he would read it and then go, okay. Mm-hmm. He called me that night and he said, Megan, this is compelling. I read the article. I want you to do a story on Inside Edition. Would you like to? Would you and your husband like to be on Inside Edition? So I called my husband. I said, oh, honey, how do you feel about sharing our story with 6 million people? And and my husband, he laughs about it now when he speaks to men's groups. He says, so I went on national television and told everybody why my girlfriend wouldn't have sex with me. but that was our story. And once again, we said, if it encourages one person, it's worth it. We did the story on Inside Edition, ended up doing Fox News. The Daily Mail picked it up in the UK because, again, you want to silence a room in New York City? Start talking about abstinence. Everyone's like, whoa, that still exists? Okay. But that was how a personal decision affected my professional life. That can be part of your message. You never know how God's going to work. And it's in the book because it indeed ended up being a part of my story. And then people have also asked me, did you feel made fun of in any way as that was all coming out? No. My boss is a father. He loved the idea, again, of encouraging young people to value themselves. And I had so many cool conversations, guys, where people would pull me aside when I was doing all these different interviews, and young people would say, I'm waiting too. Thank you so much for speaking out. I thought I was the only one. That's worth it.
Thank you so much for sharing all of that too. And I know for a lot of our young people here too, so all of our students, I've had a lot of conversations with them over the past few years about taking steps into the unknown, which is really what all of you have done. And really, which is what's so powerful about your stories, is that you've continued to take steps that have led to the place that you're sitting here now, because you've taken steps because the Lord has called you into the spotlight. So how would you encourage our young people as they're finishing college, they're getting ready to graduate, and they're about ready to take that first step into the unknown? What advice would you give to them as they take that initial step?
That is such a great question that I wrote a whole book about it. Because I think that's, every person's different. Every story is different. I would love to sit down and find out their passions and their dreams, their skills, their talents, utilizing your network, who, you know, right around you can encourage you in this journey. It's a marathon, not a sprint. I just want young people to know it takes time. And again, that first job, midnight to 6 a.m. shift, $9 an hour, you know, but it's a small step forward. So I would just encourage them, just begin. Sometimes we just need to take a step and begin. And whether that's just showing up, they say showing up is half the key to success, showing up and beginning to cold call people, send those resumes, network. I think just talking to people and sharing your interest is so important. I just want to encourage people that it just begins that first time you decide to talk to somebody and just go for it.
And I would say you have to know that if you're a believer in God, that he already knows, and he knows it may be a while before you know, but that's still okay. I love the marathon sprint idea. When you look back at the Bible, and you look at Abraham, you look at Moses, those guys, when they were called to something, they had no idea what God was going to do. And for both of those guys, it took many years for them to even figure out what it was God was going to do through them. And yet they heeded the call. And when it got tough, and there were a lot of tough times, they hung in there. And ultimately, they accomplished wonderful things, not only for the kingdom, but for us, that we can look back and see that example. So I think from a biblical perspective, we see that that's there. Your faith, it will be tested, both in Christ and also your destiny. It's going to be tested. But look, if it's any good, it needs to be tested. That's how you know if it's worth having. So those times of trial and those times of difficulty, that's when you really bond and understand it more. And you may live most of your life before you figure out, this is exactly what God had for me to do. And I just figured it out after all this time. And Megan's right. You got to take those early steps for that to happen. So be who Christ called you to be. But you don't figure it out when you're 22 years old. At 25, we got this thing all worked out. And we figured it out. It's just not the way it is. It's never designed to be that way. A faith walk is just that. It's a walk by faith. So be patient. Hang on. Lisa's got something. This will be good.
It always is, coming from Lisa.
I would just say, too, you never know whenever you're young what your past will lead you into either. I know that, you know, whenever Al and I first got married, I was 18 years old, and I never, ever would have thought that he and I would be doing what we're doing now. Whenever he became a pastor, I never thought I would be a pastor's wife. I didn't want to be. I thought it was a joke. I thought it was a cruel punishment from God. You know, because I said, I don't have that personality. They're supposed to be meek and mild and quiet, and that wasn't me. Also, I don't think any of those people have ever been through the things that I've been through. They don't have the past I do. They're not scarred like I am. But I was wrong about that. We're all sinners, and we all have things that we are not proud of, things that we've done that we regret. But never would I have thought, even whenever we went into ministry, that one day we would be where we are doing what we're doing now. And I know 17 years ago, whenever we were trying to decide whether we were going to stay married or not, never would I have pictured us sitting on a stage or sitting in a room in a restaurant like we were at lunch, or this morning sitting in a dealership, you know, talking to influential businessmen. Never would I have thought that we were going to be sharing our testimony and telling them about where we've been, but where God has brought us to and the incredible thing that he's done in our lives. So I think you never know at this age. And you know what? I'm 50 and Alan's 51. I don't know what we're going to be doing in 10 years. Because he may have something totally different for us to do in 10 years or 20 years. So you really never know. I think what you do is what God, the gifts that God has given you. And he's given gifts to everybody. Everybody's is different. The gifts that he has given you, that's what you use. And you use those to glorify him. And don't be afraid of change. Because you know what? In 10 years, you know, we may be on a TV show by ourselves, which scares me to death. I can't even think of that. But, I mean, you just never know. But in faith, we trust in God, and we walk the walk with him, and know that in the end, he's going to be there with us, and we can deal with any of it.
Well, thank you guys for sharing your stories. I know that everyone in this room, as this morning and this afternoon, has truly been touched and moved and inspired by who you are and the stance that you've chosen to take in your life for faith. So with that, too, I would like to be able to open it up for questions to our audience. If any of y'all do have a question, we have a mic that's set up right over here. Come on over. Sorry for the stroll for you. I apologize. There you go. By all means.
Good evening, guys. My question is, let me give you a little backstory. Move this up or whatever. I came in contact with a gentleman named Jimmy Graham, who's a former Navy SEAL, and the discussion was about business and his Christian faith. And along with the discussions we had about 3 years ago was, how come he never went to see his pastor? And it's not necessarily for you, Al, but all of you. The question becomes is, how come he didn't see his pastor regarding his business? That also brought questions of my faith. And one of the things I did was began looking at the parable of the talents. The talent was the largest currency in the first century, up to 200 pounds of gold or silver. That means that 75 pounds, one talent would be worth $1.5 million. Five talents would be worth $7.5 million. So the question is, from your perspective, how does a Christian businessman, as well as wealth, how do you handle it? Because how would Jesus do business?
That's a good question. And, you know, obviously a big part of the show is we have a business, and so... And we have done well and been successful, both in the duck call business and then, of course, now much more in the entertainment business. But you make a great point. You know, God, everything, you think about it, for the creator of the cosmos, even the figures you just mentioned or all the wealth here means nothing when you made it. So to him, you know, it's all his. You know, he made it, the potential for it, how we divide it up and what becomes precious to you or me. You know, to him, it's like, you know, but it was the management, which is the part behind the whole parable and what comes first. And so to your question, I would say that's where you always have to start as a Christian, is my commitment to God will never change, no matter how much or little I possess while I'm on this earth. But that I would want to possess more to do more good things with it is not an anti-godly thing. Sometimes we get the idea that all riches are bad, but that's not true, and that parable proves it. But how you manage it, multiply it, and then, more than anything, give God glory with it and how you use it is the most important thing. I told this story this morning. When Dad got an opportunity to speak for one of the first times about duck calls, and by the way, there's not a lot of duck call, there's not a lot of duck hunters in the country. There's about 800,000 duck stamps sold last year. So we're not talking about a huge pool of people. And that's our pool that we do business with. Dad was in New Orleans 35 years ago. He's in the Superdome. There's about 400 Cajuns out there. And they came to hear him blow his duck call and tell why that's the best duck call. So he gets up and he blows his duck call. And they're all looking at, oh, they good. That commander good. You know, and all these Cajuns are talking about it. And then Dad... After he finished his duck call thing, it just strikes him. He's like, in this moment, he was standing underneath the sign that said Anheuser-Busch, King of Beers. you know, and the Cajuns were enjoying their beers. And so Dad thought, you know what? God's got me in this moment. I just need to tell him about what changed me. So he reached in there and he gets that tattered Bible and he holds it up and he says, "Oh, Anheuser Busch, you may be the king of beers, but I want to tell you about the King of Kings." And I mean, it got silent in there. And so then he told them the gospel and they were just silent. I mean, you could hear a pin drop. I was there. I was a teenager. And everybody's just looking, and they weren't sure whether to clap or what. But what do we do, you know? And they're all hiding their beers behind their leg, you know? It's like, this guy, he just, like, ruined our little happy moment, you know? And this, when he's walking off the stage, the guy comes up, Dubuisson's his name. He was our duck call seller in New Orleans. He said, "Phil, you can't do that. You can't do that. You can't mix religion and your business. You'll lose it." And Dad was just incredulous. And he said, "I'm talking about the resurrection of the dead here, son. I mean, that's what the business is based on." But what that established in my dad and in me as I heard that in Duck Commander was a culture that Jesus Christ would always come first. And success and prosperity, if they ever came, and trust me, for 30 years, we didn't have much. We fished and made enough money to pay the banks off, and that was it, because we were having some humility 101 to get ready for what we're doing now. But that culture was established in us. And I think as a business person, that always has to be there first. When that happens, then you'll stand up for him, and then he'll show out and do awesome things. I think Satan, I love Dubuisson, he's a great guy, but I think Satan put him in that path to try to be a deterrent to Dad, but Dad wasn't listening. And from that point forward, right up until a big dust-up with A&E, we've been standing on principle and what's right, and we've maintained success. So that's a long way to answer the question, but that's the way I see it. Any rebuttals?
No, that's great.
I think, Elle, you just sort of answered the question. I was going to ask you about, at the end, I think it was the first season with your dad and the producers regarding bringing up Jesus and using his name and at the end with the prayer. And I think you answered that. I'm a devotee of Duck Dynasty, as many of my friends, so I can tell you that at the end of the program, when you have those prayers, it actually ties, that means so much to the fans. I think that's what draws that whole program and the family aspect together.
Well, I'll tell you a couple of things. I'll tell you a funny story about the prayer. The very first episodes that ran, they put beeping in, first on Corey and then on Willie. And so we're watching the show, the whole family, you know, the very first episode, we're watching, we're all excited, and I was looking around there, I said, "What did y'all say that they had to beep out?" And they were like, "Oh." Then they're starting to think, well, it was nothing bad, you know, because they don't curse, you know. So we asked the guys after, because they're there, the producers were like, "Well, what was the beep?" And they were like, "Oh, that's just what you do in a reality show. That makes it funny." You know, we're like, not to us, because that's going to give a false impression that we were saying things we wouldn't say. Please don't do that, which they stopped. So that was the very first thing. Second thing is they were taking in Jesus' name out when Dad would say it at the end of the prayer. And it's just a tradition. It's not like it has to be said at the end of every prayer. But you know how most of you pray, you say in Jesus' name. And it just irritated Dad that they were cutting it out, because he couldn't figure out why. I mean, why would you cut that out of the prayer? We're Christians. We're praying about Christ. And so finally they kind of hem-hauled around. And finally some guy, the director or something, says, "Well, you know, we just don't really want to offend people that, you know, that don't believe, or maybe they believe in something else, and we just think it'd be better if we just left that out." So Dad was like, "Well, this is ridiculous, you know." So the next time we filmed was a family dinner scene. So Dad sits down. He's not happy about this situation, not sure exactly who to talk to get it up the chain. So we figured out how to do that. So he says, "Okay, Mr. Phil, it's time for the prayer." So everybody bows their head. Dad starts into his prayer. "We're grateful for another day here on planet Earth. And Father, I hope you just give these old boys here from New York and L.A. a chance to repent for all of their ways of wanting to cover up you." And he just went into this whole sermon in his prayer, you know, and he said, "I hope you save them from the fires of hell, because you know what? I'm worried about them. And they probably won't run this, but in Jesus' name I'm praying this. Amen." So everybody that was there looks up, like looking around, and everybody looks at Dad, and he's just looking, and the camera people and all the crew, their eyes are this big, you know. And so the director says, okay, Mr. Phil, that was something. Could we do it again and maybe tone down a little bit on the crew and the fires of hell part, you know? So Dad does another prayer, but it was interesting because the message got up, and so about two or three episodes after that, they left it in for just one, and then it was out a couple, then it was in. That what they were doing is they were testing the water. Most of political correctness is done out of fear of things that may or may not ever happen. But it's always like, well, what if, what if, what if? Instead of most people knowing that anybody that was offended by that sort of thing was probably not going to be watching Duck Dynasty anyway. And if they were, they understood we were Christians, that's what we do. So I think it was a good lesson for us to realize that we know what motivates some people doesn't motivate us. But we did figure out to stand up for ourselves, which made a big difference. And you're right, the prayer has made a huge difference. We hear more about that than anything. And it wasn't designed to be that. The guy that directed our first two shows was a lover of the Dukes of Hazzard. And so he was living his dream by being with these rednecks from Louisiana because he thought, I have found the real Dukes of Hazzard. That was his what his thinking was. He considered himself an agnostic Jew when we talked to him about his faith, which is, I was like, agnostic Jew? That sounds like, you know, an oxymoron. This was a confused individual, right? Because even Jews believe in Yahweh, right? So I couldn't quite figure that out. But so he imagined the end of it being us around the dinner table, no prayer, of course, that wasn't part of it, and then, like, they were going to hire Randy Travis to do, like, a good old talk over, like, oh, Si did this and Mount Man did that, you know, and it was going to be that kind of thing. But what it became was a prayer and then Willie doing a voiceover about, you know, no matter what you saw tonight's episode, at the end of the day, we're together, we pull for each other, we're a family. And so that message and that prayer have become the theme of our show. And it's very astute of you as a fan to realize that because that has what's made it successful more than anything else. And it wasn't planned except by the Almighty.
Well, great. Born and raised here in Colorado, 66 years. I got to say that my 1968-69 stay at Fort Polk, Louisiana. So I have a great love, appreciation for the state of Louisiana, enjoying down there, at my time down there. Another question, if I may. Megan, 30 years in the TV business, retired, but you touched a little bit about things going on behind the scenes. Also being a Bronco fan in the days of Tim Tebow and the criticism and the angst from NFL, the viewers, can you touch base a little bit about what you witness behind the scenes regarding Tim Tebow and contrast that what's going on today, not only different teams around the NFL, but here in Denver regarding the taking the knee and the national anthem issues? Because it definitely is affecting the fan base, the people that I know, and the groups, the people that I associate with, they really enjoyed and loved Tim Tebow, and now we're seeing the pendulum swinging the other direction with what's going on in the NFL today. I would wonder if you could just touch base a little bit about that.
Yeah, that's a great question. Well, I covered the last two seasons for Thursday Night Football, so I'm not covering this season. So I've been a fan, watching like everybody else, as everything has been reported on with what's going on in our country and everyone's feelings and reactions. I will say this about Tim Tebow. There were definitely moments at Inside Edition when he was taking, you know, a knee after a touchdown for the Broncos. It's Tebow time. We did a story on Inside Edition about how just the phenomenon that was. And I remember walking the hallways of the newsroom and somebody going, oh, that Tim Tebow, can you believe that guy? He's waiting until marriage. And I remember jumping in and going, I think he's awesome. Oh my gosh, I am so glad we have somebody like Tim Tebow. And the producer's kind of looking at me like, what? So it, as a news reporter, I would say this is the whole concept of a seat at the table. Somebody like Tebow, like Russell Wilson, Peyton Manning in many ways, these guys that are out there that are living their faith, doing excellent work, incredible players, good players, they're in the mix. They're competing, right? They're competing on the big stage. how fun is it for me as a reporter to get that to report on and to be doing those stories about Tebow time and Russell Wilson. I got to cover the Seahawks when they won the Super Bowl and then when they lost the next year. And Russell Wilson is consistent as quarterback for the Seahawks in his faith as he wins and then as they lose. How cool is that? So I'm a messenger. You know, I'm telling people stories and just the encouragement to, again, have people get in there, get in the game and compete with the best of them and be true to your faith the whole way. We know how influential these athletes are and what role models they are. So, yes, many cool conversations where, you know, I just got to praise them behind the scenes, have conversations with, you know, people on the show about how cool I thought it was. And then, yeah, just with what's going on right now, again, I would just say, you know, you guys, you know, you have a voice, you're part of the process and, you know, tell the media what you think as these stories are being reported on. And we're seeing this conversation go on in the country because they're listening. I know in San Antonio, we literally read every single email we got at the TV show. Don't ever think that those don't go unnoticed. They do. So be a voice, you know, with what you see.
Thank you.
Great question.
So we have time just for one final question. So I'm going to go ahead and ask you guys, as a part of the CCU community, how has community and making sure that you're invested in your community, whether or not it's your family, friends, how has that been able to keep you accountable to living out your faith? And what does it look like for all of our students and our guests to be able to invest in community? Why is that important?
In our case, you know, when our show was getting ready to air, our local newspaper, because, you know, this time, you know, think about it, Swamp People was very popular. I don't know if it was the Kardashians were out yet, but maybe they were. And then, but you had just had a final run of Jersey Shore. You may remember that show. Some real beauties up there in New Jersey. And so there was, you know, reality TV became something that for a community could be either something that was really embarrassing, Honey Boo Boo, just to throw one out there, or, you know, he's like, where is that at? Because you're starting to wonder, right? Or it could be something that you were very proud of, and those were more rare. Down south in South Louisiana, they love the Swamp People. So do we. They're awesome families. So in our case, our local paper in their op-ed thing was openly saying and asking, you know, and hoping that when Duck Dynasty came out, that our community was going to be proud of what we did. And they were kind of just laying it out there in faith because they had no idea. The next week after the show aired, they read another piece and said, we're so glad that this show is in West Monroe. And so I thought it was a great openness on our just local paper people to recognize that this could be something very good for our community or something that we would be embarrassed about. Obviously, they're proud of us. We do a lot there, and we like to stay, you know, super grounded there as well. And so Mom and I are fixing to open a sweet shop, which we're very proud of, Miss Kay's Sweets and Eats, that my daughter and son-in-law are going to be working at. We have Willie's Duck Diner that is there in town, along with John Luke's Ice Cabin, where he sells snow cones, that's been on the show, as well as Duck Commanders. Just think about all the different things that have been there. We're based and locked in. We love West Monroe, Louisiana. We're all over the country. But, you know, Friday when Lisa and I touch down in Monroe and then drive across the river into West Monroe, which is better than Monroe, I'm just saying, you wouldn't know, but I'm saying, we're going to be so glad to be home. And people have to have that and that love for it. And, you know, for the college students that are here, both in what you guys are doing to try to build something base here, a lot of you guys are going to go everywhere. And so you're going to be a part of a lot of different communities. Some of you will do mission work and do other things where you'll be, your community will be the world. And so you got to grow where you're planted to make a difference. But you also got to have some roots somewhere at a place that you can call home. I tell you one thing, now that Lisa and I have grandkids and they're in West Monroe, we realize how important it is generationally to be close together as a family, as close as you can be. And so we would definitely encourage you guys to do that.
Just a quick answer about community for me. It's crazy busy in New York City. You know, long hours on the job. I'm there to perform my task again. That I knew what I was getting into. But for me, it's been really important. After being in New York for a couple of years, I formed a Bible study with a couple other ladies that you would recognize that are on TV right now. And it's community for us to let down our hair, talk about what's going on the job, ways we can encourage each other on our assignments, and just to be us in the industry. And my dear friend Kelly McGuire wrote the foreword for the chapter of the modern Proverbs 31 woman in my book. And she talked about this concept of having people to walk this life with you. Real brothers and sisters that you can be real with and be authentic with. That is precious. For me, it's just a few people in New York. But at the end of the day, that's all I need. My community's small there. But just a couple good friends, you are a wealthy, wealthy man or woman, I think, if you have that. And then to be in Nashville later on in the week with my family, it's wonderful. It's been great for my kids. I feel like I can have sort of a foot in both worlds. It works for us. Again, I realize, especially with millennials, you got to do what works for you. The sort of traditional models in many ways are so different for us with our generation. Again, with working women and what that means for your family and what that's going to mean for your life. So you figure out your community where you are. Be flexible. Be creative. God will meet you. And hold on to those good, good friends when you find them because they're important. Iron sharpens iron, right?
I was going to say, too, that... whenever Duck Dynasty started, we got together and met at our house because we figured out early on that we weren't going to be able to be a part of it. You know, they were filming 12 hours a day, sometimes 6 days a week. And when you're in ministry, you don't have that kind of time to give up. And so we opted out and we just said, let us be your cheerleaders from the side. Let us be your sounding board, and let us always be the ones that can come and call you back whenever you get out too far. And so that's what we did, and that was mine and Alan's role. And pretty much it still is, even though we're on the show. We have a house church, is what we call it, every Sunday night. And it's with the four brothers and then some of our employees. And our kids are there and their kids. But we do that because we want to keep everybody grounded and we want to keep everybody knowing that this is home. This is what life is really about. It's not the spotlight out there. It's not the TV show. It's not going off and doing Dancing with the Stars, although all of those things bring glory to God. It's being our family, our community, right there in West Monroe, that we can lean upon because life is hard. And you know what? It doesn't matter what age you are. Sometimes there's just things that you go through and you need somebody to talk to. And so that's what we have in one another. We have it in my sister-in-laws. We have it in the brothers. We have it with Phil and Kay. And so that's our community on Yellowwood Drive in West Monroe is just a house church that can meet and we can share our struggles and encourage one another.
Thank you so much. Well, you guys, as a community too, here at CCU and as a part of Centennial Institute, one thing that we want to make sure to do is not only lift each other up in prayer, but to make sure that everyone who is choosing to live their life in the spotlight is lifted up in prayer. So if you guys would join me, I'd love to pray over you. Dear Lord, we are just so grateful for the talents that you have given every one of us in this room. I pray that you'll give us courage to step forward in what it is that you have for us, that you would allow us to dare greatly and be bold. And I pray that in that, that you would be really, truly just a part of every step that we take. I thank you for Megan, for Lisa, and for Al, and for their time that they have taken in choosing to go across the country and share the story that you have allowed them to take part in. I pray for their careers. I pray that you would richly bless every move that they make. And I pray that you would be in the words that they speak, in the actions that they take. I pray that for the Centennial Institute, we would continue to pursue faith, family, and freedom, and in that change culture and move in culture in ways that only you can do. I pray for these things. I pray for everybody in this room. In Jesus' name, amen.